Hello viewers, today we are going to do capital management and we will be touching upon topics relating to borrowing powers, mortgages and charges and debentures. This is unit 5 of the company law portion. What do we mean by borrowing powers? The company, whenever it requires funds, either it can go for a capital issue through the shares or it can take up loans, which is exercising of borrowing powers. And thirdly, it can issue the debentures and take up loans from public financial companies. In this study today, we will be doing sections 149, section 292 and section 293 relating to the borrowing powers. The company, it is entitled to borrow only if the objects clause permit the company to borrow money, or it is a trading company, since a trading company has an implied power to borrow. The object clause of the company should contain the right to borrow, which means that if there is absence of the clause to borrow the money, the company cannot borrow. But this is not so in the case of a trading company, which has the implied power to borrow. So even in the absence of this clause to borrow, a trading company can exercise its borrowing powers and take loans from the public financial companies and from the banks. The borrowings shall include the borrowings from banks, private and public financial companies, and any other loans which are extended to the company, either through the employees, directors or other people who have a stake in the company. Now, according to the section 149, no borrowing can be exercised until unless a certificate of commencement of business is received by the company. Now, this requirement is there only for the public companies who have a different date of certificate of incorporation and another date for the certificate of commencement of business. After it has fulfilled certain conditions relating to the directors who have subscribed to the shares, no amount of money has become repayable. And thirdly, when the company has issued the prospectus and filed the statement in lieu of prospectus to the ROC, then it is entitled to receive the certificate of commencement of business. So after it has received such a certificate, then the company can exercise its borrowing powers. A public company is required to get the certificate of commencement of business, and it shall not carry on any business or borrow money until unless this condition has been complied with. Another section which deals with the borrowing powers is section 292, which imposes certain restrictions on the powers of the company to borrow. Firstly, the borrowing of money should be by issue of, if it is by issue of debentures, then such power shall be exercised by passing a resolution in the board meeting only. It can be recalled that only the board is competent to issue the debentures in their meeting itself. The onus or the responsibility to issue the debentures lies only on the board, and shareholders do not have a say over it. So, whenever the borrowing of the money has to be done through the debentures, it will occur in the board meeting. Secondly, if the borrowing of money is otherwise done by the issue of debentures, then such power may be exercised by passing a resolution in the board meeting only, which means that the board can be empowered to pass the resolution requiring the borrowing of money other than by the issue of debentures. So if it is permitted, then the board can also pass such a resolution. Secondly, this power could also be delegated by the board, provided the resolution delegating the power to borrow money is passed at the board meeting only. And secondly, the resolution of the board shall specify the total amount that may be borrowed. Now, this kind of delegation of power could be done to the committee of the board comprising of the managing director and few other directors. This committee, which has been formed by the board meeting by passing of the resolution, shall be entitled to sanction all these resolutions requiring the borrowing powers which can be exercised by the company. The company, whenever it requires fund, then the board committee shall meet and pass a resolution sanctioning the loans which it can take from either from the public financial companies or from the banks. Now, section 293 imposes certain statutory limits on the borrowings. Besides the limits imposed by section 292 regarding the quantum that can be borrowed and regarding who can borrow, there are certain restrictions which are imposed under section 293, which imposes statutorily what can be borrowed and how much can be borrowed by the company. The board of directors of the public company shall not borrow money which will exceed the aggregate of paid up capital and free reserves. So, the first quantum restriction is that the borrowing should never exceed the total of the capital and the free reserves which are there with the company. Until and unless a sanction of shareholders is obtained by passing ordinary resolution at the general meeting, such a restriction can be relaxed if there is a sanction in the general meeting by the shareholders. That means even if the borrowing is exceeding the total of the paid up share capital plus free reserves, then also the borrowing power exceeding that limit can be exercised. Now, the limits on the borrowings under the articles. The borrowings by the company must be within the limit, if any, which have been specified in the articles. The articles of association of the company can impose other limitations on the company to exercise its borrowing powers. It could be that not more than 50 lakhs could be borrowed by the company from externally from the company. So, that means even if 1 rupee exceeded from 50 lakhs, then it will become ultra vires. Secondly, the limits could be laid down for the company as a whole or its directors. So, the limit could be either over the company, that the company cannot borrow anything more than a certain specified quantum of money, or secondly, it could be that the directors who are sanctioning the borrowing, they have been restricted from sanctioning such a borrowing at their own, either the managing director who can sanction not more than say 20 lakhs or any other director who cannot sanction more than 10 lakhs. So, the board or the committee whichever is sanctioning such a borrowing will be having a limitation to which it has to adhere. Now, we will discuss the ultra vires borrowing. The meaning of ultra vire means beyond the powers. Whenever the limitations imposed by the articles are not adhered to, or the limitations which have been put in the memorandum are not adhered to, or the statutory compliance under section 293 are not complied with, then the borrowings shall be ultra vires or beyond the powers. So, basically there are two kinds of ultra vires borrowings which can be done by the company. Either it could be ultra vires the company or it could be ultra vires the directors. As we have already studied that there could be restrictions which can be imposed on the directors regarding what can be sanctioned by them for borrowings. Whenever they exceed that authority, then it is called as ultra vires the directors. Similarly, when the memorandum and the articles limitations are not complied with and the borrowings are exceeded beyond the limit which has been fixed by the articles, then it is ultra vires the company. So, let us see in this these points. Any borrowings by a non-trading company shall be ultra vires the company if the power to borrow money is not expressly stated in the memorandum. We had earlier stated that the power to borrow should be sanctioned in the memorandum, and a non-trading company need not obtain a sanction in the memorandum because it has the implied powers to borrow. Secondly, any borrowings by any company shall be ultra vires the company if the borrowings are made for a purpose which is outside the object clause of the memorandum. So, one could borrow the money or the funds from the external authorities only for the objects for which it has been formed. The objects have been divided into the main objects, ancillary and incidental objects, and the other objects. Whenever a company wants to pursue its main objects and incidental or ancillary objects and it needs funds, then it can borrow the funds from the external authorities. But if that money which has been borrowed or the funds which have been obtained by the company, if they are misutilized or misapplied other than the ones which are stated in the objects, then it will be ultra vires. Now, the persons who have provided the fund may be put at a question, and they would be risking their money if there has been an ultra vires borrowing. We shall be discussing the consequences of such a borrowing. Now, what happens if the borrowings are ultra vires the company? If the borrowings are ultra vires the company, they are void ab initio. Being void ab initio means being futile or waste right in the beginning itself. That means it does not have any legal effect if the borrowing is found to be ultra vires the company. Being ultra vires the company means which is ultra vires the memorandum and ultra vires the articles of the company. Secondly, the shareholders cannot, even if they are acting unanimously, ratify the ultra vires borrowing. If there has been a borrowing which has been ultra vires the company, even if all the members who are present at the general meeting want to sanction it and unanimously agree to ratify such an act, it will be futile and it cannot be pursued and it will be considered as ultra vires borrowing. Thirdly, the lender shall not be entitled to any securities received under the ultra vires borrowing. The person who has provided the fund and has been given some security by the company regarding the borrowings which has been obtained by the company, he shall not be having any right to such a security and the whole contract shall fail. Although no valid contract subsists between the lender and the company, the lender may be allowed the following rights on the principle of equity. Now, consider a situation in which a company which has in its object to lay down the railway lines and it gets a contract to make the bogies for the train. Now, since this contract to make bogies is not in the objects clause and it requires now funds, supposing Mr. A provides a fund to the company to make the bogies and the company wants to pursue this object, although it is not been mentioned in the memorandum. Now, what shall happen? The supplier of the fund, Mr. A, shall not get any security which has been offered by the company for the provision of the loan that has been given to the company. Hence, it is an ultra vires borrowing and the contract shall fail. In this condition, though, the lender who has provided fund has got certain remedies which we will now discuss. If it is at all possible to trace the money in specie, the court may grant an injunction whereby the company shall be restrained from using such money. Injunction means an order of restrainment from the court. That means the court will then issue an injunction and stop the company from using the fund or parting away from that fund. So, if the money can be traced and if it is found intact and has not been applied, then the court will be granting an injunction or stopping the company to part away with that money so that it can be refunded to the person who has lent that money. Secondly, if the money obtained through the ultra-vires borrowings is used by the company in discharge of any lawful debt, the lender shall become a creditor of the company. Now, supposing there is a limit which has been imposed on the company through its articles. The limit is that the company can borrow only up till 50 lakhs, which is equal to the paid up share capital plus free reserves. Now, anything more than that shall be ultra vires. Supposing the company has already exhausted that much borrowing, that is, it has already taken a borrowing of say 50 lakhs and now it requires more funds. It goes for a further loan of say 10 lakhs. A person who has supplied the loan does not know that the loan of 10 lakhs which he has supplied is ultra vires. But this 10 lakhs which has been provided is now used by the company to pay off an earlier debt of say another 10 lakhs. So now what happens is that after the discharging of the intra vires loan by the company of 10 lakhs, the lender shall now be subrogated and he will enter the shoes of the legal loan provider, that is the intra vires loan, and hence he shall have all the rights of the actual lender. So this ultra vires loan will become intra vires. Now this could be for the whole of the debt or it could be for the part of the debt. Say for example, if in the case of 10 lakhs which had been provided by the lender, if only 5 lakhs has been used to repay an earlier debt, then only 5 lakhs will become the intra vires loan and the lender can exercise his rights regarding that 5 lakhs. The other 5 lakhs which remains ultra vires, the lender shall have no right in regard to it. Now thirdly, where the money has been obtained through ultra vires borrowing is spent by the company for acquisition of any asset, the lender shall have the charge on such an asset. The third situation could be where the money has not been repaid but it has been used to purchase a certain asset. When the whole of the money has been used to purchase an asset, then the lender or the provider of the loan shall have the right over that asset, and that right is called as a charge. A charge means a security. So the lender shall be having the right to that asset which has been purchased by the company using his funds. Fourthly, the lender may hold the directors liable for the breach of warranty of authority. In this case, where the lender does not have any notice it was an ultra vires loan and he has relied on the directors while supplying the funds, then he can hold the directors liable for the breach of warranty of authority. That is, they have exceeded their powers, the directors have exceeded their powers, hence the lender can obtain the loan from the directors of the company who have breached their warranty. Now let us discuss the borrowings which are ultra vires the directors. Earlier also we discussed that there are only two kinds of ultra vires borrowings. One is ultra vires the company, that is beyond the memorandum, and secondly is the ultra vires the directors, that is the directors who are exceeding their authority to sanction the borrowing. If the directors borrow money even where the restrictions have been imposed on their powers to borrow money, such borrowings are called as borrowings intra vires the company but ultra vires the directors, or simply borrowings which are ultra vires the directors. Now it has to be noted over here that the company might have a blanket sanction for the total borrowing that can be done by the company itself, but it can impose certain restrictions on the directors to the limit which can be sanctioned by them. So over here, when there is an ultra vires borrowing by the directors, the company still has the right to sanction such a borrowing by the directors if there is an agreement between the members in their annual general meeting or the general meeting, and such a borrowing is sanctioned by them. So the ultra vires borrowing by the directors, if it falls within the purview of the company, then it can become intra vires the company itself. Now what will happen if there is a borrowing which is ultra vires the directors? The lender shall have all the rights to recover the money from the company, relying on the doctrine of indoor management as laid down in the Royal British Bank versus Turquand. However, if the lender knew about the restrictions imposed on the powers of the directors, he shall have no right to recover the money from the company. Now, this case of Royal British Bank versus Turquand is called as the Turquand rule of indoor management, in which case if an outsider is dealing with a company, then he assumes that everything which has been done to sanction the contracts, all those restrictions in the company and all those obligations have been complied with. He is not supposed to have knowledge of the internal working of the company. Hence, even in the case of ultra vires borrowings regarding the directors, he can assume that all the conditions for sanctioning of the borrowing have been complied with, and hence he should get restitution. In this case, where there has been ultra vires borrowing regarding the directors, the lender shall have all the rights to recover the money from the company, and he can rely on this doctrine or the Turquand rule. But supposing he is a regular lender, he is the regular money provider or the fund provider to the company, and knows that there are certain sanctions which have to be complied with. So he has full knowledge regarding the business that has to be conducted in the meeting in the company and how it has to be conducted. In such a situation, he is not ignorant and he has not acted in good faith. In such a situation, he cannot recover and has no right to get back the money which has been given to the company. With this, we are concluding our today's session. In today's session, we discuss section 149 dealing with the borrowing powers of the company. We also discuss section 292, which imposed restriction regarding the borrowing powers, and section 293, which had statutory restriction regarding the borrowing powers relating to the total of paid up capital and free reserves. Also, we discuss certain terms called the ultra vires borrowing and the intra vires borrowing. Also, we discussed regarding what the creditor or the money provider can do when there is an ultra vires borrowing which has been done by the company in that case. I hope you enjoyed the session. Thank you.